all those things really force the industry to blend and fly.
The other thing is
that there's residual scale that they're found in their dishwater. So sometimes even if the dishwater that you think might scale won't scale because of residual scale inhibitor that's all over from the frack. The other is that the scale inhibitor is always going to be used as part of your frack formula for most people because they're worried about the interaction of the formation water and the completion fluid. And those interactions will start to form scale, and then you'll have a scaling problem as well. So you're going to add a scale inhibitor during the frack anyway. So all those combining forces really kind of eliminated the need for a lot of TDS. And what we started to see in the industry approach is what they refer to as clean brines. So ultimately, what did that mean? Well, that meant that you went from this oxidation, some type of oil solids control, and then a solids polisher step. And this became traditionally what most produced water recycling programs look like. Now, I talked a little bit about oil and solids and said they were less important. Now I'll talk about why that's becoming really, it's not that they're less important, it depends on where you are in the transition of your program. And so beginning a stage of your program, it becomes very important. Later stages, it becomes less important, and I'll explain what I mean by that. So as people start their initial field development, and they start going with their party disposal routes, and then that's how they develop the field. Then they realize that I can develop my own disposal routes. I'm going to put some infrastructure in, and that will cut my costs if they start to do that. As they get into recycling, then they go into this service model where they, same way they started with third party disposal, they're going to hire a service company to set up a recycling program and help them start recycling. But as they get further along and they start developing their infrastructure, what we started to see is the same trend that happened with going from third-party disposal to their own company-owned, so they're building out their own recycling facilities. So as we started to recognize that, we said, well, do we really just want to be a service company supplying a service, and ultimately their goal is to eliminate that service and have a company-owned recycling facility? So we got into the business of designing and building equipment to serve that part of the market. So when I talk about oil and solids control not being required or not as important, it's only because they've developed those oil and solid control systems within their infrastructure. And because it's already there, it's less important as part of the recycling tool. But if you're in these early stages, well, then you need to have that as part of the program because you just don't have sufficient infrastructure to handle it. So it just depends on where they are and what part of their overall development. So if you look at a typical produced water cycle, you've got produced water coming out of your wellhead. Well, there's some oil, water, solid separation at the wellhead. Then you go into your tank battery. In the tank battery, you're selling your solids, you're separating oil, you're recovering oil there as well. You go from your tank battery into a distribution system, lemonade system, you're again collecting solids, removing oil, and then you go into a disposal valve. What we see more and more happening is that disposal valve has the option of putting in some pits and becoming a recycling facility and using the same service equipment. But if you look at what the number of locations where they're separating oil and collecting solids, you know, your typical number will produce water under 30 ppm oil if it's maintained properly. The problem is you have the occasional upsets and things like that you have to worry about. So we started to see more and more people optimizing these programs, these systems that are there, and less contracting for those services, having a service company do it for me. So we started to see another trend, which is kind of interesting, is that we started to see people look at, after their glenbrook systems, is this idea of putting primary pits in and then storage pits. And their primary pits really became this control point. So my treated water goes into the primary pit first, I can settle out solids there, I can overflow and into my main pit and use that pit as a clarifier and let it drop out and keep sedimentation there. I also, if I have breakthrough, because I have some emulsified oil that didn't get collected, I can put a boom and skimmer in there, I can collect that oil. If I have upset, again, the boom and skimmers can collect that oil, and I can turn that device into this flexible primary pit into a flexible treatment system or treatment unit instead of using fixed tank systems. One of the reasons that we think people have been doing that is that their fixed tank systems are designed for a specific capacity. And as your water quality changes, or let's say the micron size of your TSS changes, you may go on and resettling those solids within your tank system, and you're going to start to see those solids settle somewhere else. And we see that about four. I set up a 10,000 barrel a day system, and unfortunately, I got pushed to 15,000 barrels because they need that much water at the frack. Well, as they did that, you stop settling in your tanks and you're settling in your tanks. And with more and more of that happening, people started saying, well, let's put a little primary pit in for a storage pit. Let that be the settling point. We'll just install suction lines in those pits, and we'll just weekly or bi-weekly pull out the solids that accumulate. And we're seeing more and more of that. Really simplified recycling. Here, you see the little picture is one of those pits where they actually did have an upset. We had a boom and skimmer installed, and within a day or two, they skimmed all that oil off, and it was fine. They actually didn't have the Railroad Commission come up and take a look, because they somehow saw the pit, but they thought that was a good best practice. They did the carbon footprint and everything else. They said, as long as you have that skimmer in there, and then boom, we think that's a good practice, and they were able to continue to do that as the primary practice. To collect any oil, for some reason, if there's an upset in their gun barrels or something happens, they could do that there. So ultimately, what did that do? Is that you really started to see some of these steps on these on larger scale recycling facilities. They started to remove some of this. This became, it wasn't they eliminated this, they just used their existing infrastructure to provide the oil and solids control and the solids policy. So we get back to sulfides, iron, and bacteria control. And one of the things that we've seen is that oxidizers handle all three of those things. And if those become primary constituents, just using a simple oxidizer becomes kind of a backbone to the recycling program. You know, everybody will talk about iron, sulfides, oil. I don't hear a lot of people talk about why. And so I want to just get into that a little bit. I think everybody initially would say, why are we eliminating iron? And the common answer is, well, because of scaling. But there's other factors at play. It can be a great friction reducer. It can interfere with scale inhibitors. It can act as a quieting, like a cost formation damage. It can cause wear on pumps and pipe, and it becomes food for iron-reducing bacteria. So you can, you know, take it at face value, but there's a ton of papers out there that talk about these specific things, from the degradation of polyacrylamides to scale inhibitor performance being affected. So there's plenty of papers out there, you can read and see it. So that's primarily why people are worried about iron. For me, the one that I think is the biggest concern is the fact that it acts as a coagulant. When you put propane down coal, you get 10% fines from that. That's hundreds, if not a thousand times more TSS than what you would typically see from the produced water. So imagine allowing a coagulant to get in there with all these propane fines that happen to be there. If you start bridging those lines, you're going to cause some problems to the performance of that well. Sulfide, that kind of goes without saying. Most people know, you know, there's sulfide scales, but really the big one is the danger of hydrogen sulfide. There's statistics where it's the leading cause of inhalation deaths in the country. So H2S is a big problem. You don't want to form H2S, you want to prevent it. You want to, you know, treat it wherever you can. And again, it's something you can do with an oxidizer. In terms of oxidant demand, I put in there a list of different oxidizers and how well they perform against different things from iron to sulfide. One of the things with, you know, all our systems, we use ozone. We do that for a specific reason because it's sustainable. We take the surrounding air, we strip the oxygen, we use electricity, we make ozone, and it's a very effective, very aggressive oxidant. But you'll see the green line and then the oxygen. Oxygen is a pretty good oxidant as well, except that it takes a long time to work. So we're going to touch on aeration a little bit, but that's why aeration is a really good, low-cost option to be part of your overall program. You know, it's a good way to sustain the quality of your water after it's been treated, but there are people who are using it to actually pre-treat some of the water before they oxidize it to get the oxygen demand down. And so it's a very good practice. It's a way to keep your overall cost down. So I'm going to talk a little bit about bacteria, why bacteria control is important. Is bacteria has to grow inside. So we need to take and measure bacteria. What we're really measuring is what's called planktonic bacteria. It's the bacteria that's floating in the water. What we don't see is all the stuff that's growing on the sidewalls and inside your distribution system. And so it'll grow to a point where it's grow too much, the population becomes a problem, and it will expel periodically. And then that becomes a planktonic bacteria. It finds somewhere else to see the cell can grow again. So we have a tendency to see bacteria grow in cycles. And so these are kind of the cycles, the lag phase, the exponential log phase, where you see a doubling of the population over time. For some, in the right conditions, that can increment can be as little as 7 minutes. Imagine your bacteria growing, doubling your population every 7 minutes. We've seen pits where they've got more runaway growth and the pits sour, and we've seen these exact type of things happen before. And then you get to a point where they just get the population grows, you get a stationary phase, and then you get into this death phase as time goes on, if the conditions don't change. Too quick on the ground. So this is a live testing of bacteria on a frac site. And you see the stage counts are down below, so you're getting 2 samples from every stage. It's really not to talk about the performance of the treatment. It's to look at the fluctuation in the bacteria counts from stage to stage. So this is what typically happens on a frac out there. And this is the kind of fluctuation you see. And too often we see people looking at on-the-fly treatment as a continuous dose strategy. And I'm telling you, if you look at these kind of fluctuations with continuous doses, it's going to help. It's not going to get you. You're just wasting your time. Unless you overdose it. And if you overdose it with an oxidizer, you're going to start eating up friction. So there's a balance that you have to look at, and you have to have a more controlled system if you're going to regulate that while you avoid those kind of problems. So people will say to us, well, you know, what do you see, you know, when you use non-oxidizing myocytes, why do you promote oxidizing myocytes? And for a couple of reasons. They're fast acting, they're easily verifiable. You can have a real-time option to know whether you're affected right then and there. And there are compatibility concerns, but they can be controlled. But ultimately, it improves your overall water quality. So you're getting iron control, you're reducing the producers in water. So if you use a breaker in frac formula, your breaker's like adding an oxidizer. So if you've already taken the reducers out, you're making that breaker work more effectively. And so then you also can control sulfites. Non-oxidizing myocytes are slower acting. You don't really have a real-time method to measure their effectiveness because most of what's happening is happening at all. It doesn't really improve the overall quality of the water. There are some toxicity concerns depending on what you're using. If you want to get into a reuse program somewhere else, you have to worry about managing those other contaminants that are in there. But the prevailing wisdom has been that I don't have a compatibility concern. That's why I use them. And I'm here to tell you there's a ton of papers out there that will show you that there are compatibility concerns with glue, water, THPS, and so they do exist. And so you can't just use a blanket statement and say, well, we don't have compatibility concerns, that's why we're going with that. So what we found is that because of those concerns and resistance mechanisms, so in other words, we're not dosing properly. And this was that last paper you see is produced water exposed alters bacterial response to biocides. In that paper, they found gluten quad existing in the water with bacteria coexisting happily, bacteria getting killed. And so it looks like it developed a resistance mechanism because they were underdosing. The paper thinks that the salt water is somehow affecting the absorption of the tricep. I'm not quite sure if I believe that, but that's part of what the paper says. Resistance mechanism, but those are kind of the concerns you have to deal with non-oxidizing process. So the difference really, you know, to be maybe a little dramatic is non-oxidizing process is poisoning somebody. And if you don't poison them and give them enough, they won't die. Oxidizing is shooting. So you're really an electron off of the cell membrane and you're rupturing it and it's gonna die. And so that's kind of the difference. It's more of a permanent kill and a verifiable kill that you don't really get with non-oxidizing offset. So preferentially, we like to look at non-oxidizing offsets as a preferable method. We think it's a better way to treat water, increases your pain, makes your breaker work better. There are concerns with some chelating agents. People use chelating agents to reduce their oxidant plant, which means you're still letting iron go down the wall. And if it's not a stable chelate, you're going to run the same problems with is a driving inner interferon with the scale inhibitor. So that's one of the things you've got to, you know, be careful about using chelating agents as part of the iron control program. So what I'm going to try to rush through now is I have a couple case studies. And when we started looking at transitioning into building and sound equipment, also rented some equipment for recycling centers. We stuck with these ozone systems, and we found that we can do it more cost-effective. And what we found is that we can actually put out these oxidation systems from the 3 cents a barrel. That's CapEx, OpEx, and included. Both of all those, and I'll show you how that pallet works. And then on the rental basis, we'll see that vary from 16 to 17 cents, depending on how much oxidation system you need, how big the system, how much water flow you have. So, we've been installing these on SWDs as centralized facilities as part of recycling operations, and we at this point have about 13 installed, as I mentioned earlier. We have four more being installed over the next 60 days, and then we have a number that are installed. And these are all fully automated, so they require no labor. There's nobody out there, they have to be able to inspect them. So this first case study, this system is set up, and these are part of the oxidation system was designed to treat water before it went into the SWD with the gun barrels and also recycle all at the same time with one system. So it was a dual use system. They were originally using a service company, paying 26 cents a barrel. We got their entire cost down to under 5 cents a barrel with our system. And that includes the cost of the aeration. You can see the raw ATP. We use ATP, it's a real time bacterial measurement. It's basically testing for all microbial activity. A lot of those bacteria have to wait for patient times, and you don't get an immediate result. And the problem with that, if I send some samples out to the lab, and a couple weeks later, the result, that part's gone. So if they tell me there's a problem with the water, it's too late, it's been used. ATP gives you an immediate result. So within a few minutes, you get a result, and you know how well you did. And you can see, we've got great ATP production. We got the iron down. We set the total iron down a little bit. Settle the total iron. Total iron is more of a solid, and the 2+ is your soluble iron. So they didn't have much in this one sample that we took. And then you see the TSS wasn't very much to begin with. Their goal was to get over 300 ORP, which we achieved. So we achieved their milestones that they wanted, their KPIs for treatment. So we talked about this being a dual use system, and one of the things that we added, you see here's a sparge bar. And that was a mixing system that we developed so we could mix with talk a little bit more about what that looks like. But after the initial installation, we installed five more 40,000 barrel a day systems, five aeration systems, and there are two more that are under construction now. So that also will become total seven 40,000 barrel a day facilities. So you'll see the top left hand corner and in the middle, that's a sparge bar. What that is, those are inductor nozzles, mixing nozzles. So they take four times of the surrounding water, mix it with the water coming into that pipe. And so what we wanted to do is we're going to recirculate that pit the way they wanted to set up a permanent system. We wanted to make sure we weren't short circuiting the pit and we're getting as much mixing in the pit and improve the mass transfer. These mixing nozzles mean every one of that water is coming out of that pipe is sucking in four times of the surrounding water, mixing it all together. That created a tremendous amount of mass transfer, and that allowed us to really expedite turning that pit. The other thing we did is add the booms and oil skimmer, which we talked about earlier. Now it's just a booming oil system. So, what were the economics of this? Well, for this 40,000 barrel a day facility, the oxidation part, which is the higher price of everything, was about an $800,000 purchase. So if I took that and depreciated over 5 years straight line depreciation, that's about $13,000 a month, or about 1.1 cents per barrel. The utility cost was about half of a penny. And for some of our clients that have better utility rates than Alcon did, they're down to 3 to 4 tenths of a penny per barrel. But in this case, it was about half a penny per barrel. The O&M, which is our weekly maintenance and upgrading facility, and includes us maintaining our systems, it comes out to about 8 tenths of a cent per barrel. So their all-in cost for our oxidation system was 2.4 cents a barrel. They were paying 22 cents a barrel through a service model before we installed all the systems. So we're going to hit on aeration here real quick and see how much time I have. So we use submersible aerators, and the reason we started using these is they're very flexible. We could drop them into an existing pit that had water. They didn't have to be permanently installed. But aeration, as I mentioned, is a good way to control and keep your water consistent after you treat it. Because if you just leave it in the pit, you'll find it just start to reseed itself and repopulate, and we'll have problems again. So this is our way, and again, it's a very inexpensive way, less than a penny a barrel, to manage through aeration and refinance, kind of most common right now. So this is us installing, this is us installing the aerators. You see them being installed over here. We use docks, we use helicopters to put them in the pits. So you can sit there, and these are mixing aerators. So they're actually mixing and adding air into the system with the small volume diffusers. One of the other areas is inventory type aerators. And so this is something that we're playing with. And if you have, for example, existing pump systems on your facility, you can take those existing pump systems, use a venturi type system, and be able to actually easily get air into the water and increase aeration. The problem is, depending on the flow rate, I don't know if it's ever. If you look at the picture, if you look at the picture up here right hand corner, you see the bubbles rising to the surface. One of the problems is in bigger pits, if your pump system isn't strong enough, you don't get a flow rate, you're not going to push the oxygen to the middle of the pit. The other problem is as your pump wears over time and your flow rate drops, your bubbles get bigger and bigger. As the bubbles get bigger, they rise to the surface faster. And so again, you may have a problem not getting air to the middle of your pit. So we had a little case study where actually we saw this occur for a client. So they started off with this service contract, a rental system from us at 15 cents a barrel, ultimately bought the system and brought their cost down to 5 cents a barrel. A couple of unique things is that they did the same primary pit concept, except they actually angled their pit so that they actually would let the solids collect in one part of the pit, put in a suction line, and just periodically pump it out. So they had a small reserve pit, and then they went to a million barrel storage pit from there. So sedimentation is really just the act of sediment particles. And one of the problems is that sedimentation is really it's a function of the particle size and the fluid viscosity. And so that means that all particles, smaller particles, take longer to settle. So as the number of the size of the particles change, we need more sediment particles. So these mixed tank systems, what was happening is that as that changed, they weren't settling solids in their tanks anymore, and they ended up in their pit anyway. So by putting in these reserve pits, you have way more sufficient retention time than you'll ever need. And that's why this thing works so well. You guys kind of like built in flexibility. So we've installed two of these systems now. This is the performance results. You'll see here that we went and got that raw ATP from 11,000 down to 210. The soluble ran down to zero, sulfites were already at zero. Total solids, once they settled, got down to 3.6. So again, it met all their conditions that they were looking for, but you see this ATP in the pit, the large pit, 862. So that's something that got our attention as well. When we said, you know, you guys look at your big pit, you have aeration in it, they had existing aeration when we installed our systems, and we said, you know, maybe this is something we need to look at. What we found is that problem we talked about, they didn't have sufficient flow, so the oxygen was never making it to the middle. Staying on the outside. So as we pulled some samples from the middle and we tried to take samples from different locations, there was just no yield there. And that's where the bacterial counts were rising in the middle of their pit and not along the outside edges. So what we did is we just supplemented their oxidation, and this is one case where we wanted to get over their bubble tubes and everything else and not mess any of the surface equipment. So we ended up using a helicopter, which surprisingly was only $2,000 to use it to the flight. Didn't think it was going to be that expensive. So we deployed them and dropped these down the middle of the pit to get more air in the middle of the pit. And that kind of solved the problem. So we see these hybrids where you're using static diffuser type and venturi type really sometimes is a better solution than just trying to settle with one or the other. So what does that mean? Well, your centralized facility becomes this, you know, oxidation in your disposal program. Oxidation is part of your pit, some aeration in your pit. And then you always have this final step up on the fly. The difference is on the fly used to be your heavy lifting. That used to be where you're using a ton of oxidation. Now it's really become a polishing step. So we kind of came up with this line of automated oxidation, our aeration system on the fly. It's the three services that you need to kind of complete your whole recycling program. But what we did is we abandoned these larger trailers we had. These larger trailers we had were a lot bigger. You know, everybody liked the way they look, but they were a lot more expensive. There's about a 25% pressure drop across them as we're trying to create as much mass transfer in the systems as we could. And that for some
some people was a problem, as people were getting 1,800 barrels a minute, that pressure might become more and more significant. And we see the whole, you know, on the fly industry having to move and shift from 100 barrels a minute. So we took the same hydrocycle concept that we developed a new trainer with an extreme chemical. We basically reduced the size, and we're getting to 110 barrels a minute. This is a kind of a breakdown. So what we've done is we've made it a lot smaller. A lot simpler to operate. It's fully automated, so you don't have to have anybody on location if you needed to, but most people want some other. And we changed the pressure up from 125 to 102 psi. The last thing that we did is we've automated everything, so we have this dashboard where you can look on in the system, you can see water quality results, you can do trend analysis, you can look at how these systems are operating. And now we're rolling out what we call hydropods. And these hydropods are floating buoys with ORP and EO strips on. You can drop them in and we'll get, it will send a signal to the hydrocyanide treatment unit and it gets all loaded in real time. So you can actually see what your pit quality looks like. Is my EO level good? Is my aeration program working? And you don't have to send some out to go pull samples anymore. So this is kind of what that concept looks like. You got hydropods floating in, you got aeration in your pit. Got some hydrocyanide treated water coming in, and this is kind of the concept that we've gotten involved into. And we're seeing more and more of the industry moving this way. If it's not us doing their ozone systems, they're going to use some kind of oxide, chlorine dioxide, hydrogen peroxide, something like that. I'll get this right sooner or later. Well, with that, I'd like to thank you all. If you have any questions,